So I'm now testing the headstock. I have already scraped the bearings somewhat. But I will show this, what I at least do from scratch here. So the first I do is to try to set up the spindle, just the spindle floating in the lower half of the bearing set. I will glue it off, of course, actually I've done that, I mean scraped it in beforehand. But anyway, you have to set it up this way, of course, with the two screws in front. So that you push on either side to get it correct, and then you snug down the bolts. And then you will have to test, of course, on top here. And I like to test with the spindle as is in situ now, because this is, I know this is parallel with the bearing sits. And I don't know precisely how good the center is. Also testing with the center, of course, because this is where you put tooling, I mean spindle mounted or taper tooling. And I also, of course, then test the front here seat for the chuck and other tools. And now I have tried sort of to measure back and forth a little bit, like try to set it to zero now. There, zero on the clock, and I will run the saddle up and down a little bit, like so. So I see it is pointing a little bit that way. So what I do then, it's not much really, yeah, maybe just leave it as is. It's a little bit of a bump, a half a hundredth of a millimeter. I can try to rotate to see if this changes. Just for the sake of it, I can try to adjust, just see which way it goes. So I take the rear here. That was the wrong way. Okay. And then I adjust again. This is quite tedious. As you can see, it's now straight here. And then I tighten down the ball and of course bolts, and then of course repeat to ensure that it still is true. Here, using this land here, of course, is dependent on the amount of wear. If this has gone much in back gear, this would be worn. So there's a little step here also, from here to here, like half a hundredth or a hundredth of a millimeter actually, of wear, half a hundredth, I think it was. So also dropping down, so this must also be taken into account. Therefore, it might be easier, more safe to use the test bar to align. So tighten all four bolts, at least snug them up first, and then check the alignment again. And this is the best I can do, after tightened it down. So I set zero there, so plus is that way. So it shall go a little bit low, if at any. So the other method would be to include, of course, the taper here. And this particular specimen is not too good. So if I find the happy medium here, let's say here is 12 plus 5 is 17. So let's say 8 then. So it's 5 and then 3 here. That's medium or in the middle. Then I will run the indicator, of course, down here. Just setting zero here. So that's also possible. As you can see here, it's a little bit high towards me here. That's not too bad, really. But it's pointing in this direction. It's a little bit too much, so I like to take it a little bit back again. But anyway, this is done by jiggling these screws, and then I also use a hammer here to lightly tap back and forth on this so to align the headstock. So that's one measurement, and then of course the same on top. So the top measurement here is also very important, so find the happy medium here again, and then run the indicator down. Not necessarily have to zero it, but I may do like so. And then this is up down there. So I'm looking for equal, but a little bit up. So this should go a little bit down, if at all anything, which it does. This is close to perfect. And then this test, of course, we'll find the outer roundness. We see if I zero it here, like so. And then there is hardly any movement. So this center, at least, is good. And then, of course, out here, I suspect some more. So find the highest spot again, up there. And then test. As you can see, taper is a bit more out. Still, that's pretty normal. It's worn, of course, and of course can be ground perfect again. These are the tests on a headstock, in addition to scraping. And the scraping here I do with blue, of course, applied, and with the a lot of blue, this will happen. So this is really too much. So I wipe off again. But I have tried them, so it's pretty okay. But as you see, you need to wipe off some blue. So I take this and then just wipe off with this. And then test again. And then that's a more typical result. But still, it's quite good. But it's a little bit down to the bottom here, and a little bit to the rear there. So now, of course, you have three types of scrapers, two of them being variations of spoon scrapers, which I find at least is good to use for pinpointing or for sections like so to make oil pockets. But you have these oil canals here anyway. So what I like to do, at least in the first, is to, especially when you have a very worn bearing, to use these knife type tools like so, because they are stiff enough so that they will be, let's say, equal overall. And then I try to take just the bottom. Don't need to apply that much force really, just take it a few times and then back and forth. And of course do the same here. Like so. And wipe off and glue again. And lastly, I will apply some oil spots, some reservoirs for the oil also. So improving. It goes without saying, of course, that you need to test again after you've done this. It also goes to not saying, of course, that you shall test the upper bearing. Like so. And both, and then clamp down also. You can test the fit, of course, just loosely so, but you have to actually take the time also to fit all this. But I do this preliminary, at least, testing so, to see that they fit. And clamping down here, you shall be able to stop, of course, the spindle from moving just by force. You may have to take down a few layers of shim, or if you actually take down too much, you may have to take down the entire bearing sides to get up to the shimming level again. Okay, this wasn't much of a fit. So now it's stuck, and then I loosen up a bit. And bear in mind, there's no shim in between here. Not now, at least. Okay. So moving up. So this is the result of one gluing. Actually, I think I turned this around. I think this was like so. Happy with the lower ones. This one needs a bit more work. And this, of course. So iteration and final fit. And then, of course, as I said, this strip here may have to be taken down to allow use of shims again, because I want to be in the, let's say, in the region where I can shim up and down. When you take off of material like this, the bearing of course gets lower, so it will contact like so if you don't take off the bearing also here, the surfaces where they contact. So to get them to contact properly with shims, you need to reduce the height like so also. And this is, as far as I know, a typical lightly used headstock, where you have just no artifacts, I mean no grooves, no no ingress that has caused stripes other than these just the burnish marks here. So this is quite okay to get down again to the level I should. But again, just repeating here, if you take down this bearing, it will sit lower. Hence, you of course, to contact again, you will get these ones closer. And then the shims that you put inside here will have to be reduced in size. But if you hit that point where you can't get any further, they will be sloppy, of course, until you again skim off these surfaces a little bit. It's not much, but a little bit. And then I put on the real spindle here. Of course, this is different than the Super 7 in that it's a thrust bearing like so, normal or more regular thrust bearing, which is sitting in the inside of this bearing, this two parallel white metal or Babbitt bearings. And then when you shall adjust the axial plate like so, you adjust the nut so that this presses on here. Then you will set the preload on the bearing also. And the radial plate is of course then, plus the alignment, taken care of in the bearing system here. So I loosen this nut, no, this screw here, which is tightened until I feel a slight drag, and then I tighten this. Then there is no discernible play here. Can of course measure how much also by just setting the dial indicator to the side here. So setting zero here, like so. Maybe there. And then we can measure how much. And there is nothing there. So testing which shim I have to use here is a little bit like cut and try. So I started with 43 hundredths of a millimeter, and now I'm at 38, and it's quite stiff, meaning that I have not much play in the bearings. And then when you see here, I try to lift, I get around 5 hundredths still, even though this is very tight. Or maybe, let's say, call it 3. Yeah, more like 3. Let me see, just taking it to 0 there. Yeah, it's about 3. So 1 to 1.5 thou play. And it's quite stiff, so this bearing will probably set itself also. And now I can't tighten this anymore, really. Then I'll just do the same with the rear. And of course, the observant viewer noticed the mistake again, namely to forget the belt. But for those of you that have not been dealing with the ML7, this is of course a key factor to not to forget, that the belt must go on here like before, or then you have to, if not, undo the bearings again. And on the gray bearings also, they should be ideally equal of size to front shims. So now we have a very tight headstock. I doubt that it remains so tight. I'm starting to use it. I can oil it a little bit now to see how tight it really is. Shall begin to sink a little bit. It does. It also then stays. So now we have to test, of course, the alignment again, just to verify, and of course test with the faceplate and the chuck. Also we have to test the seat here. That's the point, that this is correct. So the seat in here, which I have measured, is okay with this, but it's better to test with, let's say, a faceplate, because then you have a lot of amplification if you have any error. So that's how I set up a headstock. Just repeat the test again, and then of course, as I said, with the faceplate, test the seat here. And the alignment to the tailstock will of course have to be tested also, so that we will have to use a center here, the center here, and do the test to the tailstock. But in essence, the tailstock needs this kind of alignment and is set up correctly, as far as I know, to the Myford specs when we have satisfied the criteria for testing the alignment here. Okay, hope it is useful for others also. It's not a lot of mystery behind this, just broken down into separate elements for testing alignment, scraping, and then etc. It's really simply very simple tests done. So then lastly, with the faceplate mounted, and like also Myford specifies, you test the alignment of the spindle is tested in this direction, but you test the spindle nose here, so the seat on the nose. So this is plus minus 1/100 of a millimeter, or maybe 1.5, so let's say within 1 thou. And then on the side of the faceplate, like so. Also within 1 thou. Plus minus a little bit over 1/100 of a millimeter. So I think that's acceptable results.